We are lucky to have a very substantive set of people today. I have on my right Minister Magali Silva, Minister of Trade and Tourism, Peru. Next to him is Mr. Andres Reboledo Smitmans, General Director of International Economic Relations and Minister in Charge of TPP negotiations of Chile. And beyond him is Teresa Carpenter, who is the Executive Director of Geneva Graduate Institute Center for Trade and Economic Integration, and the Institute is also a partner for this session. On my left here, we are very fortunate to have Vice Minister Nguyen Cam Thu. I hope I pronounced the first one
right.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah, as close as I can get, because in my language we don't have that sound, so I apologize for that. But Vice Minister Cam Thu, Ministry from the Ministry of Industry and Trade of Vietnam, and then at the end of the left side, my left side, is Madame Evelyn Herfkens. She has been a minister in Netherlands. She has been in charge of WTO issues, and she's been thinking of and writing on mega-regional aspects. So very quickly, to take forward the issue, we are today in a world where, with the conclusion of the negotiations, and I was told that in effect negotiations continue till the agreement is finally adopted by the legislator, but as USTR Froman has said, that no more negotiations. Yes. So we will start with the presumption that we know what TPP is all about, but we'll know it only after about a lot of study and experience. But we have people who actually have been involved in the process, have thought a lot about it. And those who are outside have thought as much, if not maybe more, because this large agreement can both serve as a model for future mega-regionals, and there are some in the pipeline. Those who are outside, I tell people that TPP is 12 countries. If I take TPP and TTIP, I add 28, that's 40 countries. We have 163 members of WTO. And so a large number of WTO members are outside. Does the TPP create conditions which pave the way for greater multilateralism? What are the problems? Why is a country becoming a member? For example, I requested Vice Minister Cam Thu to tell a little bit about why did Vietnam become a member? Because the provisions are onerous. And if you take that into account, how should those who are involved in TPP think about those who are not there? First, after this point could be approached after we know what is there. And then, how do we see TPP as a model for the way world of trade and investment will develop? And how do we then create a world in which we have much greater partnerships? Because world trade and investment does not follow the contours of any single mega-regional. So with that, I also would like to say that Mr. Andres Reboledo has to leave at 4 for attending a meeting. And I thank you, Minister Silva, for making arrangements so that your ambassador could sit in for you in that meeting. So I'm really grateful for that, and we all will benefit. But what I intend to do is I would like him to have the floor first. And then in about 15 minutes, I would like the people to raise questions for him, even if all the speakers have not finished. So you have the floor, sir.
Okay, good afternoon. Thank you very much for the presentation. Thank you very much for the invitation. I would like to thank that they have the opportunity to discuss with you, to exchange ideas in an issue which is quite important, exciting, and precisely in the moment where we are and the place where we are. Because I think that we are in the exact moment and point where we have to decide this kind of matter. Two blocks from here is going on something which is absolutely crucial for the business international community, for our countries, and for the system, if I say so. So thank you very much for this opportunity. There is no doubt that the multilateral trading system is the best forum to negotiate liberalization measures and to adopt and improve common discipline for all. Chile is a small country that depends on international markets. So we need rules to be applied to everybody, especially to the big players. However, those multilateral processes have not advanced at the speed at which many countries need. This is why Chile, in parallel, has also taken the bilateral approach in order to deepen the trade liberalization with our partners. We have been experiencing several changes in the international environment, and this is particularly remarkable in the way the negotiation began to show, moving to the plurilateral format in which Chile has participated in recent process as a Pacific alliance in our region with Peru, Mexico, and Colombia, and in, of course, in TPP. Being part of TPP gives us the chance to introduce regulatory convergence with the standard included in the agreement with the rest of the 11 members, which we have already agreed with. This has a special relevance in regulatory issues, such as sanitary issue, technical barrier issue, rule of origin and custom procedure, among others. TPP negotiation arise in a crucial moment of international trade. Difficult with the Doha round enhanced TPP as alternative to advance in significant trade liberalization and other important issues related to the international commerce. I would like to share with you why Chile has followed such an open trade approach and has made the international opening one of these most important pillars for our economic growth. With the return of the democracy more than 20 years ago, our country carried out a dynamic bilateral trade negotiation policy. But at the same time, we have had an active presence in the most important multilateral economic organizations, such as WTO, Latin American Integration Association, APEC, and OECD. Therefore, we have been very pragmatic, and we have explored and implemented all the approaches in our effort to deepen our link with the world economy. Consequently, it should not be surprised that Chile has decided to participate in TPP negotiation. As you all know, TPP is an ambitious plurilateral economic integration process. So our participation in it is the expression of our international policy during the last 25 years. Beyond tariff relations issue, TPP will set a new standard for other regional economic integration agreements, and to some extent, for future negotiations in WTO and APEC. Under this point of view, it is very interesting for Chile, its participation in an instance that will design the pattern and global rule of international commerce for the next decade. Facing the reality that Chile is open economy, we are going to continue in the avenue to liberalize trade and exploring agreement that improve binding discipline that reinforce certainty. But this reality doesn't mean that Chile is willing to sign any agreement disregarding its content. On the contrary, we welcome more openness for trade, but it's necessary to build a balanced outcome between what the trade partners seek and maintain, but at the same time, maintaining the internal space for implementing and preserving the internal public policy. A particular example that illustrates this is the TPP chapter on intellectual property, in which Chile committed to the high-level standard in many different areas in order to promote innovation and investment. But at the same time, Chile was able to negotiate a chapter that allowed us to maintain the right and the capacity to regulate such a quite sensitive area like the public health and access to the medicine. Nowadays, we face new challenges in the international scenario that we couldn't foresee at the beginning in the 19th. Last decade have witnessed a historical landmark, and as a rising of emerging economy and the eruption of global value chain, with the split of the production process across a number of economies. Global value chain emerging as a consequence of the strong expansion of international trade, lower transportation cost, and the acceleration of the technology progress. Under this scheme, international commerce has multiplied on the basis of the export and import of intermediate goods, along with the traditional exchange of final goods and services. International disintegration of production has been possible because enterprises have left apart the concept of vertical integration and have started to operate distributing the stage and production tasks on different countries as a way to reduce cost and raise efficiency. On the other hand, the slower and limited progress of the multilateral trading system has given rise to mega regionals. Today, there are several plurilateral negotiations ongoing. At the same extent, they are competing to create the new frontier for trade rules, TPP, the Pacific Alliance, the agreement between the United States and European Union, RCEP in Asia, and the recent agreement in APEC to launch the process of the feasibility study are examples of the new of this new trend. All these initiatives reinforce how important become plurilateral processes and are expected to pave a path forward a more dynamic trading system between countries that have certain common interests. Mega regionalism is a new phenomenon in international commerce. These agreements do not only concentrate in tariff opening. They are focused in creating the condition to deep liberalization of market access in goods and services, and have the particularity of establishing new standard frame or regulatory convergence negotiating independently of WTO disposition, and go further than what is established in the multilateral trading system. In this scenario, Chilean trade policy has foreseen preparing for the new order seeking for better opportunity for its export and import in short and long term. Chile started this process when in 2004 our free trade agreement with South Korea came in force, being the first trans-Pacific FTA in the world. And then with the signing of P4, it was the basis of the TPP. Chile has also been pioneered by negotiating with China in 2006. These are examples in which the decision of Chile commercial policy brought positive impact in our country. Go ahead, Asia kickoff in this impact world map. Finally, I would like to make some remark on new commercial topics. The TPP has been called the 21st century trade agreement, principally because for the first time in the history of trade negotiation, new issues were uncovered. Indeed, the agreement contained provision on regulatory coherence, anti-corruption measures, and small and medium enterprise, among others. Additionally, the agreement contained provision of great interest for our country, such as the environmental chapter, with measures about conservation and trade, biodiversity, climate change, environmental good, and illegal fishing. We are convinced that we have the opportunity to take advantage of the new trade trend to our own benefit and provide the world higher world inclusion and finally prosperity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your speech. I now request Minister Magali Silva for her statement, and then we'll just break for a few questions.
Good.
And then I'll go on with the Vice Minister.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Singh, for inviting us to have this opportunity to share with you what our countries have been doing for the past 5.5 years. Back then, it was before around 2003, 2004, where three countries, Chile was one of the leaders there with New Zealand, and it was Brunei came later, but it was Singapore was the P3, the three countries that started realizing, you know, they decided to get together and to see the world from a different perspective, see the Asia Pacific as an opportunity to grow, to expand their markets. And, you know, 2 years later, there was Brunei, and there was a P4. And then all of a sudden, it started growing. It was the U.S. that joined. And we Peruvians hosted the APEC meeting in 2008. And at that time, the president that was there, President Garcia, was invited to be part of the TPP. And then we never stopped until we received Japan 2013. And it was until, you know, a couple months ago, Atlanta, 5 o'clock in the morning, we were all struggling, right, without having slept for a couple nights, and when we finally concluded the negotiations. So it was Atlanta at 5 in the morning, and we closed the negotiations on that day, on a Monday in Atlanta. So after that, you know, we celebrated that among all our differences, because if you see the 12 of us, it's like Jesus with the 12 apostles. I mean, we're so different from each other, right? We represent three continents, right? Three different stages of development. Some of us have to do different tasks in order to achieve those standards. And some of us will have to do a lot of transformations in our economy just to be able to compete in equal conditions. And there we are, and then we closed the negotiations, and we said we are going to publish the text within 30 days. And we succeeded, right? On the November 5th, the text were available for everything. For everyone that wants to read it, it's 9,000 pages. The three languages of the TPP are English, but are also Spanish, Mexico, Chile, and Peru, are in the process of doing the translation, while at the same time we're doing the legal scrapping. But this is all the logistics about what it has been, we have been, working towards the end on TPP. But what it actually means, this agreement, like Andresa said, is the 21st century. We negotiated 34, 33 chapters. First time that SMEs are there and they have a chapter for themselves. It never happened before. SMEs were treated as regular businesses. But no, in TPP we decided they deserve and they need to get a different treatment. They need to be there, because if we don't think of them, if we don't think of the basis of our entrepreneurial, el tejido empresarial. Well, actually, you excuse my English, but if you don't think of the SMEs as the basis of our economy, actually, because in some cases it's 98%, 94%, 95% of all the enterprises or the businesses SMEs account for. So it's very an important sector that needs to be focused, that needs to develop their certain tools for us to take advantage of what it means to be able to play in the real world with all the odds against us, because SMEs are the ones that have to put the TPP into the essence, which is to generate jobs, to create more conditions for other people to join. And the global value chains won't be able to exist
if the SMEs don't participate. So we started a very active and dynamic process of getting our SMEs in our own individual countries to take part of what we call the accumulation of origin, or which is, for example, you allow me to take some examples of Peru. Peru has a very developed textile industry, but also a very developed metal mechanics industry. So if we produce certain parts of vehicles, then we can export, the SMEs can export system brakes, different parts of automobiles, go to Mexico, and Mexico can export with TPP conditions in all the agreements that Mexico has. And if we relate, for example, in the textile industry, we can, Peruvians can import buttons from Malaysia, right? And maybe yarn from, or cotton from the US, produce it in Peru, make the garment in Peru, and export all over the world. If you don't work from the basis for with the SMEs and for the SMEs, none of this, none of the benefits that the TPP has would be really effective for people, for real people, because the 9,000 pages, this doesn't mean anything if we don't work for them to make, to take the opportunities, to be able to get better jobs. In other things, in other chapters too, that for in the case of Peru, as I said, the most important chapters is the one dedicated to SMEs and the benefits of the rule of origin and that we generate and accumulate origin, which is very important. Another chapter that we have been discussing is something that growth has to be inclusive. If we don't include every time more people of our economies, we won't be able to continue growing. Because it used to be, right, in order to distribute, in order to create a more inclusive growth, you have to continue growing. But you also have to continue adding new sectors to the economy in order for us to continue growing. And that means inclusive growth. That means that many of us in the among the 12 TPP countries have developed public policies in order to include more people in the distribution of growth in the growth itself. So those chapters, we have a chapter consider what is development policies that we have to continuously be working in order to make them inclusive in our agreement. The TPP is an inclusive agreement that has thought exactly of those that are at the basis of the pyramid. Or for those, for young people, for example. We also have, as we have in the Pacific Alliance, the cooperation chapter. The cooperation chapter means that we're going to impose scholarships for young people that we can get across our 12 countries, that we can help each other to succeed in problems, in solutions of problems that some of us have encountered. For example, we are speeding up the process, and now that I'm looking at my fellows from Vietnam, for example, Vietnamese companies are going all over the world, right? Because in Peru, for example, we have a lot of call centers, and Vietnamese companies are seeing a new opportunity for them to go to other countries, go global, right? And for example, TPP would speed up that process because we have a special entry visa or whatever for businessmen, right? So among the 12 of us, we're going to practice what we see, that the elimination of barriers for people and goods and services to circulate among other countries. So I can go on and on and on. I mean, like Andres has already mentioned, this is a very ambitious agreement. We go from investment, for example, we go dispute settlement in order to speed up. And I also wanted to add that in the case of Peru, for example, Peru has been like Chile also, even though we started later as they did, to open up or to relate to the world, to integrate to the world. We have 17 FTAs, free trade agreements, and the TPP means for Peru, five in one. Five agreements, five free trade agreements, which we didn't have with Australia, with New Zealand, with Malaysia, with Vietnam, and with Brunei. So that means five in one for, you know, the 5 years that we've been negotiating, we get those agreements in once. Another benefit, that a concrete benefit that we gained from the negotiation was that in a plurilateral or basis, you end up revising what you already had in on a bilateral basis. Exactly, in the case of Peru, was the agreement that we signed with Canada and with Japan. On those cases, we have recovered more benefits than we had for the entrance, for example, of our agricultural products. So in terms of the gains that we are experiencing, we also have had those gains. We also, when we signed the FTA with the US, that was like 5 years ago, we already did some of the reforms. For you to have an idea what the FTA with the US have brought to Peru is the production of more than 200 legal decrees that we had to update our environmental legislation and our labor legislation. That means to meet standards that were higher than the ones we had. So even though we are members of the International Labor Organization, we have been increasing the protection, obviously, of labor and the protection of the environment, because that comes together. And something that we also, and we feel very proud that we've all achieved in this TPP negotiation, is that for the first time in one free trade agreement, the knowledge of rural communities, of ancient communities, have been recognized under the IP chapter, the intellectual property chapter. For countries like Peru, for example, that have an immense biodiversity and a very rich culture, more than 5,000 years of age, and taking into account all the knowledge that those communities have, we have been very, very protective of that knowledge. For the 12 countries to recognize the wisdom that it is in our communities, and that it is very important that and that they have the right to be recognized. So those are in essence, what the TPP has meant for all of us, means new opportunities and means new rules to continue working on getting on, you know, showing that yes, we can get, if we practice flexibility, we can find common areas to work together to bring more jobs to people. And finally, I would like to add that a lot of other criticism that has encountered the TPP, we in Peru encountered that when we were signing or when we were negotiating the FTA with the US. The three critics were, one, that it was a secret agreement. But believe me, all in the case of Peru, and if we've been seeing that people doesn't, countries don't negotiate because until the negotiation isn't finished, you can't show your cards to the opponents. You have to continue. Once you've negotiated, everything is transparent and everything is for the public, and we have been confronting the Congress and the media and our stakeholders to explain them what we've signed.
The second criticism that we encountered was about dispute settlement, that in the case of Peru, the government, the state, was losing power when you negotiate with multinationals or with foreign companies. And this is not, does not have anything to do with free trade agreements. We, as in the case of every country, are sovereign. We are the owners of what we produce, our government, our laws. And in the case of Peru, the rights, the property rights, are completely protected for the Peruvians, for foreigners, because the law is there, and we are members of international agencies that we can go and find solutions if we have certain disagreements. In the last, and that even that started in Peru even before the free trade agreements that we started negotiating. That is 25 years old. And the last one was, the criticism was that the price of medicine were going to sky up, that we were not going to find any medicine. And after 5 years of free trade agreement entered into force, because we have statistics and evidence to show you that none of the fears that were spread for the FTA with the US got actually came into reality. The prices, to be able to compare, for example, the general prices, which is measured by the inflation, or inflation measured measures, shown that in those 5 years, while the general average of prices went up by 3.2, prices of medicine only or increased by 2.8. So less than the general increase in prices. Right. Okay, 4 minutes or 1 minute?
It's almost
4. Oh, I'm sorry. Four. Yeah, sorry. So those are the criticisms that we encountered, and that I would like it, I wanted to share with you, with showing some numbers that this didn't occur. And the last sentence is that free trade agreements are just roads, new roads, for private sector to go and to use the roads. They're faster, they're more secure, but the last decision to take that risk and to go and to use those roads is on the private sector. The government is there to facilitate, but the decision is on the other side. So I would like to thank you, and excuse me if I end up...
For us, so that's why I was not really reminding you of
sorry.
The time. No, that's
sorry.
Okay. But thank you so much. And we will have the minister's thoughts even during the subsequent interaction. But maybe we can have one or two questions. Is that
okay?
So, a couple of questions. Is there a microphone? So, one question here, then one, two, three. So, okay.
Thank you very much. My name is Aryan from Indonesia.
Very short.
Yes. I have two very simple questions. Yes. The first one is about the SMEs and IP protection in TPP. If you combine both, I haven't read it because it's 9,000 pages. But if you combine both, that's actually all the chapter on SMEs and TPP and IP protection combined with the notion of global value chain actually will have some impediments from developing countries' SMEs to actually increase their local capacity and lower their bargaining position vis-a-vis the lead firms of big multinational of the developed countries. That's one. And then second very simple question is, I really would like to know what is the public perception in both Chile and Peru on the issue of TPP. Was there any division between the academia, the think tank, the civil society, and even the government itself? Was there, how do you actually come up as one voice when you're negotiating TPP, that actually it is in the national interest of both Chile and Peru to join TPP? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, I'll give to Carlos.
Carlos Primo Braga, MD. A long time ago, Alejandro Jara, former Chilean ambassador, I know.
He's the creator before.
But this was a long time ago. He wrote a piece called The Benefits of Promiscuity to summarize Chilean trade policy pursuing trade liberalization both at unilateral, plurilateral, and multilateral level. And Chile has done very well, and I congratulate Peru by being also on the same track. But my question is very simple. What do you think a mega region like TPP means for the multilateral trade system? Does it create new avenues, it's a laboratory to experiment, or it's really going to add another nail to the coffin in terms of the credibility and relevance of the multilateral trade system?
Francesca.
Francesca Bianchi, World Economic Forum. I'd like to address a question specifically to Minister Rebolledo. Minister, you mentioned the APEX Free Trade Agreement, the FTAAP. Of course, this is a much more expanded TPP with countries like Indonesia, Korea, China, and Russia, which manifested their intention to join. Do you think the FTAAP could actually happen? Is it realistic?
Okay, thank you very much for the question. And I think that you have made a key question, I mean, at least the last two one, because that is the exactly the moment where we are. We have to challenge that issue today in the world. That's the reason why I said when I started the presentation that here to block from here, they are discussing also the multilateral rule, and also we need to reach some agreement and to deliver and to show to the community, international community, that the multilateralism also is working and also is a possibility. And it's a tool for a country like Chile, that we are a small country and we need rules, we need traffic light, that especially for the big player. That. So I think that there is a tension, of course. I mean, to be very honest, that I think that this regional agreement put tension in the system, and also among this regional agreement, there is a competition, if I say so, because there are many important agreements today around the world that are creating the rule. Okay. And so what would be the rule for the future? What would be the rule for the near, for the present, if I say so? And the rule that we create here in TPP, or the rule that they are creating, or could be created in the APEC agreement? And in that regard, I am a little optimist in that. I mean, I'm more optimist than I was some years ago. Because my impression that at the end of the day, by the way, the idea to raise and to create an APEC agreement was created 10 years ago in Chile. And was that idea are coming from the, not from the governmental community, are coming from the business community. They proposed and they put on the table the idea to have this, mega agreement. And I think that we are closer. And I mean, in front of us, we have a long time, and because we need to go over the different step, but we made a decision, a political decision in Beijing the last year, to enter in a very preliminary stage, which is the feasibility study. And that feasibility study is gonna have a result, and that is our hope in the Peru summit in the next year, and in APEC summit, presidential summit. And after that, we had the possibility that we are going to have the basis to make a decision, a political decision, to go to enter in that process. I don't know what is going to happen, because of course there is a tension between this, all these trends that are going on here today are around the world. And let me say a few words regarding that the question that raised for that guy of the from Indonesia, and which is I think that is part of the most challenging discussion, at least in the case of Chile, I'm sure in Peru and also in all the 12 countries that were involved in TPP, which is the we have to deal with our civil society in a different way that we were used to. Even in the case of Chile, we have facing a situation which is a little funny sometimes, because you can hear critique from the people that they approve our 25 agreement before.
because the chain, the world have changed, our country have changed, but we take that situation into consideration as a governmental authority. Otherwise, that because at the end of the day, this tool, this agreement has to be approved in our Congress, and also. I think in terms of transparency, but also in terms of dialogue, is the essential. To be, I mean, very frankly with you, it's a challenge, but we have to work on that. Thank you.
Any comment on Carlos's question?
The ambassador.
He had said, is it a path to multilateralism, or is it a nail in the...
I think that the only comment I can make about that is that this today and tomorrow is crucial to answer that question. Because we are here involved in the multilateral negotiation. We have limited our expectation, and now we are waiting to have something in agriculture, which is quite important for the country like Chile and the many countries in the South Hemisphere that we export food, and but also as a systemic result. And I think that to answer that question, it depends on what is going on today and tomorrow. Because if the WTO doesn't have the possibility to show something, I think that as a negotiation function, WTO, we have to make some question mark about that.
I just also wanted to add that, you know, humankind has hope right now, because a couple of days ago, we were able to find agreement on environmental issues, something that we didn't have much hopes, and we Peruvians organized the COP20, and we moved that decision a year later to Paris, and finally we reached an agreement. And if we were able as humans to find a solution for environmental issues, I am very confident that right now we're going to find an agreement for this WTO meeting. Thank you so much.
Finally, I would like to say that in Chile, Alejandro Jara has very follower like us, because he's a creator of the P4. We have to say that guy is seated in the right of the room. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I now will move to my left and request Vice Minister Kamtu to share his thoughts with us, and then go on in the sessions as normally in the sessions. It's a very unusual day today in the negotiations, so we were lucky to have two persons here, we are very thankful that you have also spared the time for us. Vice Minister, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Asha Singh. I think that in general, generally talking about TPP was beautifully said by my previous speaker already. Let me concentrate on two questions you put for me. First question is related to the multilateral system and the TPP. I think that now it's the globalization is becoming widespread, but the international trade is now not only limited to the traditional areas such as tariff reduction and elimination, liberalization in services or investment activities, but it also affected by other non-traditional areas. In that situation, you think that the WTO is still remain the cornerstone and the foundation for the international trade agreements. And the value of the WTO still remain. And the organization still play a key role in enforcing the rule-based international trade system and act as an important forum for trade negotiation to ensure growth and fair trade. But at the same time, we need to be very frank about the current status of negotiation in form of WTO, so that we can work out a more effective approach. In that context, I'm of the view that the WTO member should still affirm their determination to accelerate negotiation in WTO, but from the other side, find a new way to cope with the new arising issues. In this context, FTRs are expected to be create a more new values for the international trade because they both enhance the level of commitment in traditional areas and address effectively the new and non-traditional issues. Those are regarded as the 21st century issues. And these newly created values help drive countries' trade policy towards greater transparency and predictability, minimizing the state intervention in the market and facilitating trade activities, promoting investment and GDP growth, ensuring sustainable and balanced development, and protecting environment and laborers. I think that that's why Vietnam decisively decided to participate in negotiating TPP with the other members. Even you are really different from the other countries. We have a different social system, economical system. You start from the very low level of development, and you should transform from the old planet economy to the market economy. So, but you think that it's worth for us to take risk. Let me recall you about Vietnam just shortly to you to remember. Vietnam has started our program of Đổi Mới, or you can understand as the innovations in 1996. And from now on then, every 10 years, you have a big leap forward. First leap forward, it was our internal reform during 10 years. Until 1995. And the second leap forward, it was set when you become a member of ASEAN in 1995. And next leap forward, it happened when you become a WTO member in 2007. And this come a time where you need a new momentum for our reform. And I think the TPP is that momentum, which can bring our country to the new stage of development. From our experience, you find out that each big step is a conform of both opportunities and threats. And you should overcome threats to get opportunity and benefit from them. In case of TPP, you see many benefits you can take from that. Let me say you some of them, you know, think is most important. Firstly, our innovation program based on two pillars. One is internal, proactive internal reform. And second is active integration into world economy. Talking about the internal reform, I think that TPP will accelerate our institutional reform and provide impetus to the economic innovation in order to build a free, transparent, and predictable business environment, which will help improve the competitiveness of our products, our enterprises, and our country. In terms of international integration, TPP is likely to say, likely to contribute to further deepening the process of international integration of Vietnam and help us to enhance the role of the country in the region and the world as well. Our development during the last 30 years have two stepstones. Firstly, it's export, and second, it's foreign direct investment. You will believe that with the TPP, with the tariff elimination in the market of TPP countries, we will likely create a big push for our export, particularly in competitive sectors such as textiles, footwear, wooden furniture, fisheries, agricultural and forestry products, electronics, and etc. Related to the foreign investment, we believe that with the gigantic market size and economy, the TPP will be a magnetic to attract foreign investors to set up their investment in the potential region of the TPP, with a view to taking advantage of business opportunities arising from the agreement. And that will likely result in huge flow of inbound investment to Vietnam. So that was the reason our government was very decisive, taking very strategic decision to participate in WTO. Even Vietnam, it seems still not developed to the level of the other members. Thank you, Mr. Assisi.
Thank you very much. So, Madam Evelyn Hufkins, and then I'd request Dr. Teresa Carpenter after that.
Thank you. Before we now all think that these mega regionals are the great new show when we all want to join and applaud about it, I really want to make the point that, at least in my view, they have a huge negative impact on the multilateral trading system. And it's a big risk. Chilean minister said they are what creates a bit of tensions, but I think it's more than that. So it's also these mega regionals totally inconsistent with the pledge that all our governments at the highest political level have been making again and again to support an open and non-discriminatory trading system. We promised that in the Millennium Goals, we promised in the Sustainable Development Goals, and here some of us just take off and start these mega regionals. Mega regionals, they do discriminate. Outsiders are discriminated. And mega regionals do circumvent and displace World Trade Organization functions. So I feel there is a huge risk. And the victims, of course, are all these small and poor countries that are not in these mega regionals. So I wanted to make that point before we get too positive about all this. Now, I am very sad to see how today geopolitics is trumping multilateralism, and that is really sad. Geopolitics, what was the objective of TTP? It was to contain China before China, from rule taker, becomes rule maker. TTIP, the other mega regionals, I think the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership needs to be mentioned here today too. The president of the European Council was very clear. The objective of TTIP is to enshrine Europe's and America's role as the global standard settings. That was the objective. So apparently for some rich countries, the multilateral system is great and fine as long as we, you know, dominate it and control them. The moment it's sort of out of our control, we suddenly need to look for a sideshow. And then we create our standards there, and then these standards can be eaten and swallowed by the rest of the world. The other countries in the world are not having any input in that, and they can just take it or leave it, they can choose capitulation or exclusion. So I really want to defend the multilateral system, and I think we should realize that this is a dangerous road. Okay, fact of life, we apparently started on that road. So let me now say a few words about the continent that I'm most concerned about, Sub-Saharan Africa, which is bound to be the largest victims of these mega-regional trends, and particularly TTIP. This comes at a time, and the timing is really terrible, that the buzzword across the continent is economic transformation. You see across the continent, government after government, creating the incentives for investment, for the first step of industrialization, for agro-processing, for leather, for textile, for light manufacturing. You see that transformation starting exactly now. Also exactly now, I for the first time see serious political will among Africans to work on their own regional integration, which is crucial. The African markets, countries' domestic markets are really too tiny. Regional integration is essential. The more, if you look at all the regions in the world, most of the regions actually trade more with each other than, you know, trade outside. Africa is incredibly dependent on exports to others, particularly Europe. That's wrong. Regional integration is of essential importance. So this is really not the time to yet handicap the Africans even more in the international trading system. And here is what TTIP might do. It was interesting to see that the European Commission made that statement, well, tariffs are really low between the US and EU, but where the European Commission was particularly interested in was the areas where the tariffs are still high. What are these areas? Agro-processing, textile, leatherware. Exactly the three areas where developing countries have a comparative advantage and where thus, you know, they might be losing. So TTIP exposes a huge risk for Kenya's exports of flowers, for Ethiopian vegetables, for Lesotho's textiles, and for Ghana's and Mozambique's fisheries. Just the problem that we have is that there's no debate about this. There's a lot of debates about TTIP in Europe, US, but not about this impact. And there's also very few studies about it, and the studies that are done are all based on the same large global economic modeling that, you know, doesn't really reflect much, I think, of the real economy. And these studies, let me give you three problems I have with the way too optimistic outcome of these studies on the impact on low-income countries. First is, there's a huge confidence in these studies that as far as there might be negative impact, that would be compensated by something they call spillover. Spillover is, I as a European will become much richer because of TTIP, and I will go on an extra safari to Kenya. This kind of trickle down, I am not really a great believer in. The second problem that I have is that although the damage in these studies is limited, they say, well, it's up to 1%. The problem with that 1% is this is the global average on low-income countries. 1% damage to GDP can hide behind the average a lot of very concrete cases where some poor countries, some poor producers are going to be incredibly hurt. So that is my second problem. The third problem is, because I'm such an African optimist, I see things so improving, I think it's wrong to only look at present exports. We also have to see what is the future export potential. And what I am afraid about, that TTIP will actually nip in the bud that future export potential exactly at the time that it might be unlocked the coming years. So it snatches away the markets before they even get a chance, for instance, Cote d'Ivoire and Ghana, to do more of the processing of the cocoa into chocolate at home. Snatches away the markets before they even get a chance. Give another example. There is a Dutch study which claims global value chains don't have an impact on Africa because they're not even participating now. So it doesn't matter what the changes will be. Now, African governments are really working hard to actually get on that first up the ladder. Okay, this is being kicked away before they even get a chance. So I think we should do something now. Am I running over time?
A little bit.
Yeah, okay. Okay, let me try to do this really short. I've been campaigning to do something about it for some time, and I'm happy to report that at least the Dutch government is now picking up this issue and came with a position that TTIP should not damage low-income countries, and elaborating that in 3 points. One is, this is the opportunity now for the US and the European to harmonize their trade preference schemes, which are now a terrible hodgepodge, would be great. Country coverage should be AGOA, product coverage should be everything but arms. Second, in terms of rules of origin, to not make them unnecessarily strict. I find that, as a former WTO ambassador, a very scary word, but you know, okay, at least there's an opening. Third, standards. To the extent harmonized within TTIP, most of it would be mutual recognition, because harmonization is difficult. Give the benefits of mutual recognition of standards also to low-income countries and not only to the Europeans. Let me finish by saying that I think this is the time for Africans to raise their voice. Africa has very limited negotiating capacity, and it really needs to focus on its own regional integration. And there should be standstill of any other trade negotiations with third parties, and I'm including economic partnership agreements in this, a standstill. Give Africa the time to breathe and get their own acts together in terms of their domestic, their regional integration. And just one example, I tell the Africans, if you talk with your American and your European counterparts, remind them of the Marshall Plan, where we Europeans, this is not about money, this is about market access, where we Europeans got complete market access to the North American markets while we were allowed to get our act together and start our own economic integration at the time. This is a fantastic example. If there ever in history a moment to replicate it, it would be now for Africa. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sorry.
So that's the view from those who are not part of the system and what TTIP might do. Basically, in summary, trade diversion and difficulties raised by higher standards. So of market access and what needs to be done in order to assist the really poor to become part of the system. Now I request Dr. Carpenter to give her views on this.
Okay, thank you, Harsha. So I'll just begin by saying I spoke on a panel this morning when I talked about the impact of mega-regionals on excluded parties, and I've been asked in this panel to talk about the impact of mega-regionals on the multilateral trading system. So first, I just want to say I'm honoured and humbled to have been on a panel, even though they've departed, of people who've actually negotiated the TPP, because I've only read it. Not all 9,000 pages, but at least I think some of the more important chapters. And so Harsha has given...
Vice Minister has to go. He's agreed to take some questions. Is that okay?
Then I'll go through my questions.
So if there are some questions, he has he's agreed to be here for 10 minutes to address any questions. So any questions for him? No? So, yeah, you have a question? Just 1 minute.
Doug Leopold from HSBC. I was wondering whether Vietnam, in its strategy, Vietnam has access to the other 11 members of TPP. If Vietnam, as part of its development strategy, anticipates attracting investment from outside the TPP area into Vietnam by firms wanting to access the other 11 members.
Whether part of the strategy is to get FDI as being part of TPP so that, that FDI can get market access in the TPP.
Right. So for example, in the case of the NAFTA agreement in North America, Asian firms have invested in Mexico in order to have access to U.S. and Canada.
Our strategy, so a general strategy, is to involve more foreign trading, foreign direct investment to Vietnam. And I think that it's the TPP is a one way to benefit our strategy in that.
So
as a result of that.
Yeah, result of that. Yeah. Any other question? Yeah, Christian.
Thank you, Minister. My name is Christian Rodriguez with the World Economic Forum. I just wanted to ask you about the labor negotiations on TPP and if the implementation of the labor chapter in particular for Vietnam implies additional challenges, or in which way are you actually planning to implement that? Thanks.
Related to the labor chapter, it's maybe one of the most difficult for Vietnam during the negotiations. Vietnam is decisive in our reform program. And our parliament not waiting until we are becoming a TPP, already preparing the next step of our reform in the labor law of Vietnam. From the other side, we are already a member of ILO, and we assigned four among seven ILO declarations. I think that it's will be helpful for us in during the implementation of agreement you have taken, commitment you have taken in the agreement.
Thank you so much for your sparing the time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, and I now request you to take the floor. I thank you for agreeing on that.
Okay, no problem. Thank you. Thank you to everyone who's remaining. Thank you. I can just say I'm a little almost surprised the TPP was concluded, because who would have thought that what started off as an innocuous little agreement between four small free traders who just happened to be located on the Pacific Ring would have led to this TPP covering some 40% of global trade and GDP. So how did it get there? It just shows that there's no lack of initiative from the three, four countries that started it, and no lack of leadership within the overall trading system to see such an agreement through. So where does it fit with the WTO? So here, you turn to the initial provisions, and you find out, as with pretty nearly all free trade agreements, the first article declares that it's consistent with the WTO and that it fits in with Article 24 of GATT and Article 5 of GATS. And in terms of the relationship to other agreements, it explicitly states that nothing there takes away any existing rights and obligations under any multilateral agreements that all parties are members of, that's the WTO, or other agreements that some parties are members of. So clearly it's supposed to build on the WTO. It doesn't replace it. And in terms of if there's any inconsistency, there would be consultations. So is this a game changer, or can this deep agreement of TPP coexist with the multilateral trading system? Well, certainly on paper it can. And I'll just remind you that in practice, the multilateral system, since its beginning of GATT, has coexisted with regional trade agreements. From the beginning of the GATT, very soon after, there was the European agreements, the European communities, and every time there was a new negotiation within the GATT, there was an expansion of the European community. And the Uruguay round was concluded concurrently with NAFTA. Wouldn't it be nice if Doha got concluded concurrently with TPP? Yeah. I know that ain't going to happen, but still, wouldn't it be nice? I did finish my last panel by suggesting that there's a danger that TPP makes WTO irrelevant, but I'd like to be just a little bit more optimistic here. I'm just going to look at how is it like the WTO and how is it different. So the differences are obvious because there are chapters on competition, investment, intellectual property, anti-corruption, labour, environment and regulatory coherence. So it's sort of like a mini plurilateral. I think with 12 countries already of vastly different stages of development, vastly different sizes, it's really a little bit like a mini plurilateral. And wouldn't it be nice if that could be in the WTO as opposed to outside it? Other ways that it's similar and different to the WTO, in terms of accessions, the clauses look very like the WTO. You can join the TPP if you want to. You can apply. And then the main criteria for being accepted is two things. One is to have the kind of clear and transparent regulations that TPP is promoting. And the second thing is if everybody else agrees. I'm not going to comment on that.
There you go.
In terms of the Secretariat, it doesn't establish, it establishes a commission, which sounds like the European Commission, but it seems to rotate. This particular agreement doesn't seem to establish a permanent secretariat. So at least there isn't a rival secretariat to the WTO. I think within the provisions, you can see that there could be scope at a later point to develop that if the parties to the TPP wanted to. But for the moment, it's a little bit like the G20 in terms of rotating. In terms of dispute settlement, well, there it is and it isn't like the WTO. The dispute settlement in the TPP comes in two elements. There's the dispute settlement that applies to all of the agreements except investment, and then there's the dispute settlement for investment. And there you can see that the dispute settlement follows the existing pattern of dispute settlement procedures within the WTO and within investor state dispute settlement. So you have essentially two elements of dispute settlement within the same agreement. Despite having trade and investment both in the agreement, you don't have a single dispute settlement. So the investment chapter has its own ISDS. So Harsha also sent me a series of questions which I'm just going to go through and answer as he asked. So will it be implemented? Well, I think so, yes. I'm pretty certain that it is going to be ratified. There seems to be some discussion as to whether the US would go through the final hurdle before implementation. But if you look at it, it looks like an American agreement. Even the text of the agreement on dispute settlement is 82% similar to one of the US treaties, the US treaty with Colombia. In terms of TPP, the way it's promoted on the USTR website, it's promoted with a little logo of Made in America, and it's being well sold, I think, in the US. If you read it, you don't even read it carefully, it's just there. It says it's leveling the playing field for US workers. So in terms of an American perspective, what's not to like? And as to whether the treaty comes into force, it has to be ratified by 85% of the GDP. So if you do the maths, I haven't done it exactly, but I think if the US ratifies and a couple of others, it comes into force. If the US doesn't, it doesn't. As for can it be multilateralized, I think it can. Yes, in two ways. First of all, there are accession clauses. That's one way to multilateralize and expand it. And the other question that I would have is, could it be plugged into the WTO as a series of plurilaterals? And maybe we'll just come back to that on discussion. So I'd just like to go through Harsh's five questions. So the first one was, what is the implication for the future of mega regionals? Well, I think this means we're going to get more of them and faster. I think TISA will at some point get concluded, the agreement on services. And regarding TTIP, I've spoken to people on both sides of the negotiations there, and both sides are quite determined that this is going to happen at some point. What shape it will be is a different matter, but certainly there will be something. As for RCEP, that is perhaps an alternative, but it's not clear whether that would happen. It's not clear to me whether there's leadership in sufficient quantity and sufficient initiative for that to really come through as a deep agreement. So I'd have some doubts there. And the other thing that we have is the SEPA. I'll come back to that on dispute settlement. The next question was, what happens to global trade? Well, it's possible here that it may fall. Firstly, it's possible that trade has peaked, and there's a nice book by Bernard Hookman explaining that it is possible that trade has peaked. And secondly, with the investment provisions in the TPP, to the extent that companies see investment as an alternative to trade, I think this could be a treaty that promotes investment, and companies can make decisions that might favour investment over trade. So there we could see global trade fall. Okay. The next question was whether and how mega-regionals need to prepare for improving participation of non-members, when I've mentioned the accession clauses, and what changes are needed in WTO to cope with future developments. Well, there I would suggest that some kind of variable geometry is needed. The ideal scenario would be that it would be possible to negotiate a series of plurilaterals that would be within the WTO as part of Annex 4, that there could then be a very easy accession to those series of plurilaterals when countries were ready. But at least they would then be in the WTO, whereas right now they're outside it. And in terms of why they're outside it, well, I wrote a paper with Richard Baldwin about 5 or 6 years ago, and we concluded, looking at the question we were asking was why not in Geneva, meaning why not in the multilateral system. And the conclusion that we came to was that if the WTO members don't find a way to discuss within the WTO some of the things that some WTO members think need to be discussed, then those members would discuss them elsewhere. Yeah. And that's what has happened. So I don't really have earlier we talked about the impact on third countries, and I'm prepared to come back to that in questions if anyone would like to, but I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Teresa, for addressing all of these questions. Thank you. I'm grateful for that. I just want to pick up some points from the speakers. We've had actually a very rich set of points. We were lucky to get the two ministers and the vice minister on a very intensive negotiation day. So, and they stayed to answer questions also. We saw two different views. One is of those who are inside, and one presenting the views of those who are outside. And precisely, the developing countries which are inside because they want to benefit from the opposite of trade diversion, i.e. trade creation for them. It was stated very clearly, for example, by the three persons who spoke on that, most clearly by Vietnam, because he talked about increased market access in certain products and increase in investment. So your question was spot on. He was emphasizing that. And I believe that when TPP was signed, the happiest capital was Vietnam, because they expected a lot of investment to come. But at the same time, it's also true, and this is something which the minister from Peru in some sense stated in so many words, that they have amended 200 decrees, and the standards which are going to be in place are higher. So it's not that standards are determined by TPP or any agreement, but it does the structure of the agreement determines what will be the likely impact on standards. And the likely impact on standards will be one, greater validation of environment and labor standards, and two, a link with private standards also, in some sense, in the supply chains. So in that context, then what do those who are not part of it do? One thing which all of them have to do, whether it's sub-Saharan Africa, whether it's India, and China, or Brazil, or South Africa, or I'm naming large countries, they need to know more about what it really implies for them. And the interesting thing is, I had done some work on what it would imply, and now I'm looking at what it does imply. And in some areas, the fears were unfounded. But in certain areas, the impact is far larger. And I mean electronic commerce, etc. I think the impact will be far larger. So there are those who are inside the tent and there are those who are outside the tent. But where is, one was tariff, where the tariff results in trade diversion. There are very few sectors, those who which the Vice Minister of Vietnam talked about. But I think much larger impact will be through the non-tariff measures or standards or even agreement on preventing location of the production facility, etc. So The other part, which it was very striking, that the minister for TPP from Chile said that it's both pragmatic, high ambition, and balanced. So the members have tried to also balance it through in different ways. And the minister from Peru talked about how the small and medium industries have been catered to, cooperation, how knowledge of ancient communities has been provided for in terms of IPR, etc. So there are lots of chapters which actually are going, and including in IPR, it's also a slight dilution. The first time the US has done so in an international treaty on use of copyrighted material by those who would like to use it for certain, say, research purpose or news purpose, etc. So it's not just high standard. It's also moving in the direction of greater balance, providing a platform for greater cooperation, information sharing, and building capacities, helping build capacities for small and medium enterprises. So in some sense, it's walking on two legs. And the question which is asked most often is, how will it become inclusive? So you have to think of inclusive in two different ways. One is to look at discriminatory provisions. The irony is, standards are the most non-discriminatory provisions. They apply to everyone. But you can't reach that without capacity. So to that extent, it may be non-discriminatory, but you need to work towards raising capacity. So what the non-members have to do, the first thing which is clear is non-tariff measures, and they have to improve capacity. US has already started working with sub-Saharan Africa on this. The other thing which I see is there are people who are actually dissatisfied with the extent of ambition of TPP. For example, the European service industry says it doesn't provide enough market access. Actually, the EU-Canada one does. So in the future, however much we may think about the excluded people, in the future we'll have mega-regionals and high-ambition bilaterals. That's the future of world trade, and we need to recognize that and get ready. And maybe two questions we could take, if there are any questions. Yes, please. Yeah, I know. I've been told that we have.
Thank you very much. I just have two questions for each of the panelists. My name is Munu Martin Luther. I work with an NGO called Southern and Eastern African Trade Information and Negotiations Institute. My first question goes to Evelyn. You said TPP poses a serious risk to the multilateral trading system, and especially with regard to African countries that have the regional integration objective. So I'd like to know what could be the best offensive mechanism that African countries can take within the WTO to respond to this and also to get something which is deliverable to them. Secondly, I have a question to Teresa. You mentioned that if some of the WTO members cannot get what they want from the WTO, they will go and negotiate it somewhere else. So at this point, looking at TIP, it contains that especially the US, some developing countries in Doha. And this is one of the critical issues that we have in the next 2 days. So I would like to know from you, what would be the implication on multilateral diplomacy itself? If powerful countries that hold much of the global economy are going to negotiate the issues they want outside, how would it impact on multilateral diplomacy itself? Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Mark Wu. I have a question for the panel concerning what you think the future of the multilateral, specifically WTO negotiations, should be. This week we're seeing the difficulty of drawing Doha to an end. How do you think Doha will end, and what do you think the future of the WTO as a forum for any type of trade negotiations will be, or do you think the play will all be in mega regionals?
Thank you. Before I request the panel members to address it, I just want to tell you that there is this feedback survey form, and if you could kindly fill it, it'll be very good for us to know about how to make improvements or which areas to look at. So, Evelyn, first you, and then...
I'm not going to even answer. I mean, I just been to a conference a few months ago where for a whole week people were talking about the future of the multilateral system. So I don't think we can really bring this up with 2 minutes before we're going to throw out of the room. In terms of the Sub-Saharan Africa offensive mechanism, what should you do with Sub-Saharan Africa? I don't think the WTO is the good place to actually raise this because the atmospherics are not really great. But I always wondered, you have these African EU summits and the African US summits. I actually attended one of these. Why are these not used by Africa to demand stuff? You've got your own relationships with Brussels. You've got your own relationship with Washington. You can use talks to bring up these issues about concern. So there, but so you have, your governments have chances enough to raise their voice. They are not using these chances enough, is my personal view. One last point. I have been thinking long about how you can have a more of an open architecture in mega regionals. And I just stopped thinking about it when I saw what TTP is. What they do is actually the same accession procedures as the WTO. You think that sounds good? I mean, I was WTO ambassador 20 years ago. I know the LDC is a little bit easier now. That is totally run by geopolitics. There was one group, that one accession working group, that even never met because one large trading partner didn't want this country to accede. Secondly, you have to negotiate with every member bilaterally. And they really get stuff out of you which is not part of what you sign on to in the WTO. It's plus, plus, plus all over. That's the open architecture of TPP too. I mean, I gave up thinking about it, even.
Teresa, if you can.
Okay, so I'll try to be very brief. What is the impact, what is the future of the multilateral negotiations and the multilateral system? Okay, so I think the multilateral system goes on, but in a two-tier system with the WTO looking after certain basic elements that are in the WTO and other things being negotiated outside. I don't think for a minute that's the best way to do it, but if things cannot be discussed in the WTO, you can't stop countries from discussing them elsewhere.
That's true too.
I think that answers both questions.
Yeah, right? Thank you. Thank you very much. There's one little piece which Evelyn talked about in terms of inclusiveness. We are likely to see within the package something on rules of origin for preferential schemes in WTO ministerial meetings. So that's something for inclusion. The other thing is, whatever happens to the multilateral system, and it will continue because issues will come back, it will not be possible to sustain it in the manner or in the structure it has today after the new disciplines which have come up. So thank you very much, and thank you for also filling the feedback survey. Have a good evening.